Well, as an animal nutritionist with a biochemical specialty, you were probably one of the early people to translate porcine stress syndrome into a model of malignant hyperthermia.
Exactly, yeah. And in fact, the first international symposium on malignant hyperthermia held in Toronto, my primary presentation was on porcine stress syndromes. And so we realized early on, because some of our pigs were dying under stress conditions, that this was probably related to that syndrome, which I, the porcine stress syndrome, which I had been taught in my educational process. So actually, I think I deserve some credit for making the linkage between the porcine stress syndromes and malignant hyperthermia.
Now let's let our viewers understand a little bit more what this is. Since you taught me, I understand what porcine stress syndrome is, but that will be unfamiliar to a number of people who would read a current chapter on malignant hyperthermia. So go back to the observations that were made in the Midwest about the pigs under stress and what was noted about them, and then how that became a nidus of an idea of potential model of malignant hyperthermia.
Right. It's actually a very fascinating story. The swine industry realized that the fat, lardy pigs they were producing were not ideal, so they wanted to increase muscle mass and decrease fat in the carcasses of pigs. So they did this genetically, and in so doing, they inadvertently selected for the mutation that predisposed the pigs not only to malignant hyperthermia, but to stress syndrome. So, for example, if you put little piglets together and they start fighting to establish social order, they will develop stress-induced malignant hyperthermia and die. The other problem was if pigs didn't die and they were slaughtered and the meat went to market, it produced a condition called pale, soft, watery pork, and the consumer wouldn't buy it. So the porcine stress syndromes then actually represented a multi-million dollar loss to the swine industry, and they were very, very interested in resolving this. And it turns out that the founder pig was a Belgian breed, that the pure breed breeders actually took that Belgian breed and worked it into their purebred colonies, and that's how the gene got distributed to the different breeds, if you will. So there's one founder animal, and Dr. David McLennan actually demonstrated this genetically, which is very fascinating.
Do I recall correctly that one of the teachings were that during the interstate transport of these pigs that there were a substantial percentage who may die?
That's exactly right, yeah. So if the farmer successfully raised these pigs, you know, to market size, put them on the truck, then once they got to the slaughterhouse and opened the back of the truck, some of those pigs would have died from the stress syndrome. Yes.
And so for the viewers, one of the things I want to comment on is this is the first animal model that demonstrated environmental stress could actually trigger this illness that looks like malignant hyperthermia. That was not described in humans until a substantial time later as an environmental stress without the exposure of anesthetics.
Right.